Welcome, everybody. It is so wonderful to have you here all together tonight, Evan. We're going to start with you. First of all, congratulations on the success of the series and your Golden Globe win and SAG Awards nomination.
Thank you.
Yep. As you so often do, you really disappeared into this role. It's such an impressive performance. And we all want to know, what was the research process like to play such an intense character?
Well, I basically read as many articles, books, timelines, confessions that I could. I watched as much of him as I could. I listened to him as much as I could. It really boiled down to two aspects. There was the physical side of it, which was sort of how he moved and walked and talked and carried himself with the age changes and the weight changes, the worsening alcoholism. And then it got into the psychological, which was the most difficult part and the most confusing. When I watched a lot of his videos, he also had a confusion about why he even wanted to do what he did, and his understanding that it was wrong and self-medicating with alcohol. So it felt like it opened up a key to playing him in that it was really a deterioration into a compulsion that he couldn't control anymore and just completely lost himself. So it was really, once I learned that, I tried to really map out the deterioration and arc that out over the series. And that was really a lot of the early stages of the prep work.
It must have been a lot.
It was a lot, yeah.
Yeah. Niecy, your portrayal of Glenda Cleveland has garnered a SAG Award and Golden Globe nominations, and you won a Critics' Choice Award earlier this year.
Yeah, girl.
Thank you.
So Glenda's based on a real person who tried to sound the alarm about what Dahmer was doing and was ignored. And so your character you aren't just representing your character, you're representing the entire community of marginalized voices in this story. And I'm curious about what it meant to you to play this unsung hero.
Well, it was very important for me to give a voice to someone who had gone unheard and overlooked for so very long, being pushed into the margins. And, you know, so it's important to finally give vent to that. And there were moments where I was completely brought to tears, completely undone, because the pain of knowing that all of this could have been stopped if you had only listened. You know, it is absolutely heartbreaking, especially in the scenes where the little Conorak boy is outside and we have a chance to save him and the police walk him right back into Jeff Dahmer's house. It is, and then to show up at his funeral later is absolutely heartbreaking. So I welcomed giving Glenda a voice, and, you know, because at one point in our lives, we may all be a Glenda, trying to be heard, trying to get someone to believe us. It was a great undertaking. Shout out to my better half who's in the audience, because on the days that I came home gutted, JB, thank you so much for being my soft place to land. I know you out here somewhere. Oh, there you go. Hi, cute thing.
And that's so important after, yeah, to decompress from something like this. Paris, you directed the episode we saw tonight, 106, Silence.
Absolutely.
So in this, we're given a window not only into the victim's side of the story, but also his life leading up to his last moments. Why do you think this one was such an important one in the run of the series? And how did you go about deciding how you would capture that?
Well, this is a show I didn't want to do, as I've said. This is a show that I didn't want to be a part of. This is a show that, because I, you know, was alive and a young person, a young black person in the time of Jeffrey Dahmer, I thought it's a horrendous idea to do a series about that. But when I heard about this particular episode, when Ryan called me about it and told me this is where the story changes, this is where the shift begins towards the victim, and those are the stories that we really want to tell. And if you watch the entirety of the episode, you'll see from episode 6 on, Glenda takes the fore and Lionel, and the other victims start to have a stronger voice. And the show really gets to its real point, is that for years and years, this you know, between the racial profiling and all the other problems, this was allowed to happen. This atrocity was allowed to happen. And sometimes when a work chooses you, and you don't have any choice, you go into it fearful and afraid. But fortunately, and I'm really grateful that you have so many of the people that were such a huge part of making it, because it's not just the director, Jason McCormick, who set, you know, really the look of the show that established it, Taylor, who edited it, Shay, who made everyone look so great, and of course, the actors. And I must say also Gabriel Gomez, who you think might be just someone interpreting here, was actually with us almost every day that we shot the episodes in the pizza parlor and all that. It was a key part of our crew to interpret it. So I was just really proud that it was a team sport. And I think the message is coming through that we really were about elevating the stories of the victims. And this, with Rodney's performance, was one of those key moments when it really touched your heart.
Penelope, you play Dahmer's mother, who is a very complicated woman, to say the least. And I'm curious how you approached taking on this character, this person who wanted to have Jeffrey's brain studied. Like, and maybe that was a good idea, maybe it wasn't, but it seemed like a really complicated part. How did you approach that?
Well, I watched, you know, there was very little to see because she was interviewed for Hard Copy, and I watched that night. She did some interviews, and she was absolutely tormented by these tragedies, and that she could possibly have a son that could do these heinous crimes. And so I just wanted to portray her as authentically as possible. And, you know, they say hurt people hurt people. And I think, you know, he was abandoned, this child, and she had her own mental health issues and postpartum depression and was medicated and didn't know probably how to mother in the way she probably wanted to. It was complicated because she loved him, and she constantly talked about how much she loved him. But I think the donating of the brain was a way to sort of try and figure out, and also because she wanted to give back in some way, and she even started a community center for HIV and was very helpful and wanting to help. But I think that was a part of it, and I think she thought that's what Jeffrey wanted, because she says in her interviews that he wanted to do something and help in some way. So I think, you know, what you said about being in, not understanding why you have this compulsion. And I think she had guilt and probably blamed herself, and then the parents blamed each other, and she was in an abusive marriage. And so it was a lot to take on, but I'm proud of being part of this show, because I think, like you've all said so far about The Voiceless, and Jeffrey was sensationalized, and he was the one everyone knew about, but nobody really knew about the parents and the victims' families. And we were shedding light on them, and they're important because they're still living with this. So, yeah, thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Michael Lernon. Can we please? Thank you. Michael, your character plays a really pivotal role in one of Dahmer's attempted murders, and she discovers some fairly disturbing habits of his. This is a really difficult subject matter. Again, as a family member of this person, how did you approach sort of confronting that your grandson was this person?
Well, apart from the fact that Evan is, you know, so lovable, it was easy to love him as his grandma. But I just have to tell you that when my youngest son was about 6 years old, he said, "Mom, if I killed somebody, would you turn me in?" And I remember going, "Oh God, how do I answer that question?" And I said, "Yes, I would have to turn you in because you can't kill people, but I would come and visit you every single day." And that was how I felt about Evan as his grandma. He was so lovable and so open and such a generous actor that it was just a piece of cake to love him.
Rodney, you play real-life victim Tony Hughes in episode 106. In it, we get a firsthand look at Tony's full life as a Black gay deaf man in the prime of his life. Can you tell us a little bit about how the writing and the directing helped inform your performance?
Sure. So I'm definitely thankful to Jared Spady, and especially Paris and David McMillan, the writer. David got what he wanted from Tony through me. And he explained to me what he wanted, and I showed him what he wanted. So it was all Paris. I mean, thanks to David and Paris.
I don't think so.